In the world of entertainment, there are only a few shows so enduring and popular that they can claim to have been performed more than 10,000 times. These shows are world famous. Les Miserables, Cats, The Phantom of the Opera, and Lion King are just some of the big names. In the world of corporate entertainment, however, there is only one show that has thrilled and delighted audiences through more than 10,000 performances, The Three Waiters. From humble beginnings in a terrace house in Redfern, Sydney, two mates with a never-say-die attitude turned The Three Waiters into the world's most booked corporate entertainment act, employing over 80 opera singers, performing in more than 80 countries, and establishing a hugely successful financial enterprise. The story of how that happened is absolutely amazing. But that's only half of it. In 2009, one of its creators and our speaker today, Daryl Lovegrove, was able to sell his share of the business and form his own company, Lovegrove Entertainment, which manages Australia's star-studded act, The Leading Men, and the 2012 Australian Event Awards Entertainer of the Year, Daryl and Harmony. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome one of the men the Americans have said have revolutionized corporate entertainment, Mr. Daryl Lovegrove, who will be hitting the high notes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Daryl Lovegrove, and you know what? I'm a showman. I'm a performer and a producer of shows. As a performer, I've appeared in some of the biggest shows that have ever been, like, we've stopped a few there, hang on a second, like Les Miserables, Superstar, Chess. But really lucky enough to perform alongside such names as Anthony Warlow, Marina Pryor, Sarah Brightman. As a producer, I've produced various types of shows in many parts of the world, including co-creating the world's biggest corporate entertainment act ever, The Three Waiters. I'm part of the only institution in the world that has been dying for 4,000 years, but still has yet to succumb. In the small stage, the small world that is the stage, we tell stories that hopefully move you and entertain you. In the larger stage that is the world, however, I believe these shows become much more than that. I believe that they become metaphors for wanting it more than anybody else. Being your own champion, being your own superstar, blazing your own path, following your gut instincts. Being eager and passionate, learning, nurturing your real lasting relationships, not being a jerk, and freeing your imagination so that you can be all that you want to be. As a showman, I believe everyone can learn and be inspired by what these shows teach us in life and in business. Not just the stories that they tell, but the stories behind them. And that is what I'm going to share with you today. Because today we're going to talk about peak performance, or what we call it in the show world, hitting the high notes. Let me play you one. It's a high C. Can you hear that? It's a high note. It's a note that helped make a certain opera singer very famous. So famous that most people who don't like opera actually know him, and in most cases quite like him. His name was Luciano Pavarotti, and here he is singing that high C I just played you. Pavarotti. At peak performance, Pavarotti hitting their very high notes. Now, just like people can become famous in everyday life and peak performance, you can also, in the singing world, become famous for singing a high note. That's what happened to Pavarotti. But you don't become famous for singing it once. You become famous for being able to deliver it any time, every time. That's what Pavarotti could do. It's what any singer worth their salt can do. Well, okay, maybe not a high C, but a high note that they can deliver, sustain every time. My argument is this. This is what we should all aspire to be able to hit life's high notes anytime, every time, to be at peak performance. But how? Today, I'm going to explain to you how it happens in the world of singing, in the world of show. And the first thing we need is purpose. When I was 7 years old, my auntie Pam took me and my brother into town to see a brand new movie that had just come out called Jesus Christ Superstar. Last kind of movie I wanted to see, because it didn't sound like a whole lot of fun, and it was the school holidays, and surely there was a cooler movie to see, right? And I remember sitting there as a really bratty little seven-year-old with eyes rolling, arms folded, oh yeah, whatever, and as the lights went down, this rock, opera, video, visual wonder unveiled itself to me, and to this day it is still the biggest life-changing moment in my life. Gave me clarity of purpose. Gave me permission to dream about being an actor, a performer, a rock star. There were a lot of high notes, literally sung and screamed in that movie, and I wanted to know how to do it. Now luckily I had the chops to take them on, both in rock and roll and later on in opera, and experienced the feeling of performing those high notes in front of many audiences all over the world. Because you see, in opera and rock and roll, it's the high notes that get you noticed. You've probably watched shows like The X Factor. Yeah, Australia's Got Talent, The Voice. It's when those contestants go for the high notes that the whole crowd goes nuts, right? And isn't it the same in life and in business? Those high notes are your successes. The things that get you noticed, the things that people remember you for. In the singing world, man, we want to hit them. In life and business, we want to hit them as well. And not just once or every now and then, but every time. And that's the message I want to share with you today. Because with every high note, it starts with a purpose or a vision. It doesn't have to be a big thing. We're not talking about a life-changing stuff here. Just a clear idea in your mind of what it is that you want to achieve. In the world of singing, we write these notes down so that the singer can see where they're going. You could say that sheet music is a little bit like goal setting. We literally write down every note so that the singer can see where they're headed from a technical point of view. But we do much more than that. We talk about what the emotional response we want the song to create. We talk about what the lyrics mean. We have an overarching idea of what it is that we want to achieve. And it's the same in the business world, isn't it? We see these big brands come on all the time giving us pretty much their mission statement. IKEA, for instance, telling us that they want to make everyday life better. Dove telling us that they want to improve the self-esteem of women. Or Google telling us that they want to organize the world's information to make it more universally accessible and useful. Clear, overarching ideas. When I saw Superstar, I knew I wanted to be a performer who made a living out of entertaining. Simple, clear purpose. Now the problem with purpose is that people seem to be not open to it. They close themselves off, whether it's deliberately or subconsciously. Kind of lost in routine, live their lives in loops, play things over and over again. In the singing world, we call it going through the motions. We're up there singing, there's all the right notes and everything, but somehow it just doesn't feel right. Doesn't move you or your audience. Purpose is a feeling. It's a knowing. I knew when I saw Superstar, I wanted to be a singer. I didn't know how, but I knew that's what I wanted to be. I felt it. I knew it. So this afternoon, you all look very tired. I've been here for 2 or 3 days, and it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. But this afternoon, I want you to open yourselves up to your purpose. I want you to open yourselves up to possibility. Those feelings in life where it felt where you were just flying. Gut told you was just right. Those natural highs. Because those are your high notes. And I want to help you hit them again and again. But rather than find your purpose today, I'm actually going to give you a little one. Just for today. Just to remind you the importance of having a purpose or a vision is. And here it is. Are you ready? Today, we're going to learn how to hit life's high notes. Am I going to do that by showing everyone in this room, 4 o'clock even though it is, third day even though it is, that you can sing opera? Sounds weird, doesn't it? I want you to envisage yourself, stay with me, stay with me. You're going to sing opera, and I want you to trust me that I'm going to help you to do it. Because don't close yourself up. Open yourself up to possibility. Embrace this purpose just for today, because we're going to do it. We're going to sing the high notes, and we're going to learn how to sing opera. Now look, if we're going to sing opera and learn to sing high notes, it's important that we can all at least sing. You guys can sing, can't you? Yes, of course you can. Let's do it. Let's do this. This is a great opportunity for us to shake it out a bit. Can I please ask everyone to stand up for a minute, because you all look absolutely shattered. Come on. We're going to shake it out. Let's just shake it out a bit. First singing lesson. Who's never had a singing lesson in their life before? All right. Let's just shake it out, because we've got to be relaxed. We've got to stand to get the diaphragm working well. It's all going to be good. All right. First thing we're going to do is just get the vocal cords working, and we're going to do a simple scale. La 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 la. How easy is that? And la 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 la. Very cool, CAA. All right. Now this time, get the lips working. Practice that. Then we're going to do the scale again. Okay. And fantastic. Some of you are still looking a little bit like, oh my God, where is he going with this? It's all good. It's all good. Just shake it out. Here we go. Now, if you look into any kind of search engine and you type in world's most popular sing-along song, most of them will come up with Bon Jovi's Living on a Prayer. So we all know that one, don't we? Absolutely, of course we do. So that's what we're going to do. Now, if we're going to do a bit of rock and roll, we need a bit of attitude. First thing about that is legs a little bit apart. Sorry, girls, that's you too. Susie Quatro, you look at all the pictures. There they are. All right, now, anything we do this must be a fist pump or a pointing. Fist pump, anywhere you like, or pointing. So we've got that bit of rock and roll attitude, and we're ready to go. All right, now we're not going to go up the heavens and do like John Bon Jovi. Wow! No, no, no. Now let's come right down low so we can all handle it. Are you ready, CAA? Oh, we're halfway there. Oh, living on a prayer. Take my hand and we'll make it, I swear. Yeah, that's fantastic. Go and sit down. That's fantastic. Well done. That's awesome. That's awesome. You see? You see? We were halfway there living on a prayer, weren't we? But we're not there at our opera yet. It's going to come later. You can do it. And that's really the next step in learning how to hit life's high notes. Having a clear idea in your mind what it is you want to achieve, then you have to have a go. You have to start, you have to take action. That willingness to take a risk is so important. When Pavarotti was up there singing the high C's, he took a risk. What if his voice failed him? What if it just didn't happen for him? If we're going to worry about what ifs, we ain't never going to hit any kind of high notes at all. As Stephen King once said about writing, you can, you should, and if you are brave enough to start, you will. There is no successful business, adventure, professional association, personal transformation that didn't start off with a small but incredibly brave step. All around the world, it's people's fear of failure that stops them from hitting high notes. Yeah, sure, well, we might all be brave sometimes and even maybe dip the toe into the water a little bit. But if you really want to make a difference, you have to start. In 1928, a guy by the name of John A. Shedd put together a selection of his quotes in a book he called Salt from My Attic. He was an American author and a professor. Not a lot is known about him, and 1928 was also the year he died. He had no celebrity, no real reason to put a book like this together, but he did it, and as a result, inspired countless thousands. Now, you've probably heard some of his quotations. In fact, recently, the National Bank created a whole ad campaign around one of them.
Bon Jovi. It's a great business you have here. What's your secret?
La nave nel porto è al sicuro, ma non è per questo che è stata costruita.
He said a ship in the harbour is safe, but that's not what ships are built for.
And there you have pretty much the ethos of every professional actor. Because if you're going to be an actor, you're going to have a pretty thick skin, because it's basically an industry of rejection. You've got to tell yourself, I'm going to keep auditioning, I'm going to keep turning up, I'm going to keep having a go, because I know most of the time I will not be cast. One of the big high notes in my life was putting together with a mate of mine a show as a bit of a joke that exploded and we took it to the world. It was called The Three Waiters. That's a story all about having a go. When I saw Superstar when I was 7 years old, it made me want to be a singer, rock and roller. When I left school, these were my heroes: Bono, John Lennon, Rod, and my personal favorite, Mr. David Bowie. Here's what I look like. It was never going to work, was it? I mean, I had a good voice, but let's face it, I look like a wiggle, and this is a long time before the Wiggles were cool. So what do you do if you've got a good voice but you look like a wiggle? Well, what we all did before the Wiggles were invented, musical theatre. Yep, people like Rodgers and Hammerstein, Stephen Sondheim, Andrew Lloyd Webber, they were all made for skivvy-wearing nerds like me. And the first show I was in was a real cracker. It was the original Australian cast of Les Miserables. Did you guys see the movie when it came out a few years ago? Yeah, saw the movie. Wasn't it great seeing some Aussies in the lead roles? The lead role himself, Jean Valjean, was played by our very own Hugh Jackman. Look at him there. Look at it. Tall, handsome. He's got it completely going on. A great picture of Hugh. There's a picture of me. You see, they were never going to choose me for that role. It turns out that I might be able to sing like you, but I only look better than him at a very considerable distance in a very darkened theatre with lots of makeup on. Luckily, genetic cruelty didn't stop me from getting into the original Australian cast of Chess. Then I got a real break. A guy called Harry M. Miller was putting on New Zealand-Australian national tour of none other than Jesus Christ Superstar. I didn't know it at the time when I walked in for my audition, but he told me later that he'd already cast everybody, except for the big guy himself. I suppose, like a lot of people in life, he just hadn't found Jesus. Oh, we're still awake. That's outstanding. You do audition, you audition, and you audition. But sometimes, you get the role.
Why should you want to know? Don't you mind about the future?
So for the next 14 months, I played one of the most awesome, vocally challenging roles in music theatre. And the experience was incredible. I got to work with fantastic people like Margaret Ehrlich, Jay LaGuire, and in the Australian tour with John Stevens and Denny Hines. Obviously a real high note. In fact, the next 3-4 years was a golden period where I sort of, you buck the trend and was sort of always in work. Which led me up to about 19, lots of plays and lots of musicals. Led me up to about 1997, which was the birth of The Three Waiters. Now, at that stage, I was sort of on my way to Broadway, but in the meantime, I still had to pay the bills. And that was when a guy walked in and asked me a question, changed everything. His name was Mark Bradley, and there's Mark here on the right. Now, he was a social photographer for the Sunday Telegraph and a semi-professional opera singer in his own right. And he walked in one day, and he said to me, "Daz, do you know any opera?" I said, "Why?" He said, "Because I've got a gig in 2 weeks' time and I'm looking for an opera singing waiter." I said, "Mark, dude, you know me. I'm a musical theatre / rock and roll guy. You know, and besides, isn't opera for fat blokes like Pavarotti? You can't get their pelvis moving. Dude, I'm young, I'm skinny. I want to move my pelvis as often as possible." He said, "Shut up, you're broke. Learn some opera. Earn some cash. Ship in the harbour is safe, but that's not what ships are built for." Yeah, sayings are all very well, aren't they? But opera? God, I'd never even had a singing lesson in my life, let alone sung opera. Well, maybe as a party trick, but that was about it. But I thought, you know, I'm the kind of guy who likes to try most things at least once. It has a few spare weeks up my sleeve. I thought, yeah, what the hell, I might just actually give it a go. What could possibly go wrong? And so I gave it a go, but I knew that this was very difficult assignment because it's opera. It's not a natural sound. It's a manufactured sound. And I did a bit of research. Turns out that about 200 years ago, when operettas, as they were known in those days, they were getting more popular, so they needed to build larger auditoriums, right? Now, this is the days before electricity and amplification. And the problem was that people who sang opera in those days sang like musical theatre people do today. But they were always competing with that orchestra in the orchestra pit. It would create that big wall of sound that separated the performer from the audience. So if you were 10, 15 meters back, you wouldn't hear everything that was being sung. Well, one really smart person came up with the idea that we simply change the way we sing. And it's very sort of simplistic layman terms, we do what we call raising our larynx. So instead of singing like this, you raise your larynx and then start singing like this. Hear that? Completely different timbre. Got a dagger-like quality and it's able to punch through that wall and hit a far further distance. And you've probably also heard opera singers, they need to be years of training. Years of training, if you're going to be an opera singer, years of training. I had 2 weeks if I was going to sing opera with Mark. So somehow I had to manufacture an opera voice. And the easiest way to do that was to copy someone. Now, all of us here, we have our vocal heroes, don't we? What about the blokes? Maybe Elvis? A bit of Frank Sinatra? The ladies, what about you? Maybe a bit of Celine Dion, Britney Spears? Much easier, that one. Well, who do you think I copied? Placido Domingo, Carreras? No, it was this guy. You know this guy. We interrupt this program to bring you live to Rapunzel's castle where we are waiting for her to let down her hair. Now, as you can hear, that is a terrible Kermit the Frog impersonation. But the point is, it's the guy behind those Muppet Show and Sesame Street characters, the kind of voice you hear coming a mile away. To my ear, he talked like an opera singer sings. I'm going to do a quick experiment to show you what I mean. In a minute, I'm going to ask you to turn to the person next to you. You might have to come over here. Yeah. The person next to you. And I want you to relive those days of the late 70s when the Rainbow Connection came out and the Muppet Show came out. And let's face it, you and your mates and everybody, you talked about Kermit the Frog and what a cool guy he was. And you used to do the Kermit the Frog impersonations. Everybody did, didn't they? If it wasn't that, it was like doing Bert and Ernie. Bert. Hey, Bert. Ernie, you know, that's the kind of same thing, getting that voice up here. You know what I mean? Right up here. We all did it. If you didn't say you did it, then you're a fibber. You're not telling the truth. I want you to relive those days, the person next to you. And we're going to do a quick exercise, okay? So can you grab the person next to you, and we're going to do quickly go through this exercise together. 10 seconds apart, I want you to really go back there, try that voice, tell them your name, your star sign, and the highlight of the conference in the last 2 or 3 days, okay? 10 seconds apart each, and your best Kermit, I'm going to hear the sound right up here, and your best Kermit, go for it. I can't hear it up here, come on. Yeah. And swap over. Come on, bit of action here. It's a bit lackadaisical over here. Come on, have a go. All right, okay. Let's bring it back for a minute, I was expecting to hear a little bit more, but no, maybe this time. I want you to now think of a simple melody. Simple melody. If you can't think of a simple melody, think of Mary Had a Little Lamb. And your best Kermit, 10 seconds each, go for it. Come on, up here. Anything you think of. That's it, I can hear it. And swap over. Okay, now. Let's have everyone back for a minute. I'm going to ask you to do something that is a little bit un-Australian, but it's really important. But it's important you don't make it up, okay? Who actually had a partner that they thought, damn, you actually do a pretty good kind of Kermit the Frog. Did anybody have a Kermit, or did everyone totally suck? Pretty much? Everyone pretty suck, really? No, nobody, I usually get 5 or 10 hands up. Oh, there's one at the back. Come on, join me. Here we go. Got to do one, just one. Have a go. Hear it. Who put the hand up? Oh, you've been fibbing, but it was. Oh, and Chris, how you doing, Chris? Come on, the best one you can do.
Hi.
Got Mary had a little lamb.
Mary had a little lamb.
Big hand for Chris, ladies and gentlemen. Pretty good, especially since actually it's really doesn't really work for the girls anyway. This exercise is more of a guy thing. Well done, Chris. You guys, pathetic. But anyway, we'll give you a chance to redeem yourselves very, very quickly. All right. So anyway, we've got this. Can I ask? Can you play that first track for me? Thanks so much. So I've got this aria, right? And it's all in Italian. So I have no idea what the words mean. And an American accent helps for some reason, and hopefully it turns out something like this. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is how I discovered my opera voice. And to the frog, I, and soon all of you, we are not worthy. So Mark and myself and this other guy, a guy by the name of David Hayden, found ourselves at this venue. And we dressed up as waiters, got a glass of a bottle of wine in our hand, and whoo, we're a bit nervous. I'm personally terrified, about to stand in front of a group of international doctors, and for spending the last 2 weeks trying to work out these arias and just hoping we're not going to get kicked out of the place. And it was very much like, you go that way, you go that way, I'll go this way. Good luck. And we basically go about to a group of people, and you're my group of people today. Gentlemen, you want to grab a glass each? There we go. And I'm the waiter, of course, and I come up and I go, hi, everyone, you're having a cocktail party, having a splendid time. So would you like a top-up? You'd like a top-up? Say, I go, pour the drinks and let them have it. The Phantom of the Opera is there inside your mind. And then walk away. Basically scaring the crap out of them. And it was fun. It was a lot of fun. You know, from that so-called one-off show, saw me having a go. I mean, singing opera for the first time, never sung it before. Having a go, being a little bit brave. That show would go on to become a comedic, operatic hoax that saw you sitting down to dinner at an event and being served by what you thought were three European singers, only to see them suddenly transform into these three amazing opera singers. Very funny, interactive, three tenors style show. From their first show in Sydney, the three waiters have gone on to be performed more than 12,000 times. It's been seen in over 85 countries, employing more than 100 singers worldwide. Do you think I was happy that I answered yes to Mark? Bit of brave, and thought, you know, what the hell? I sure was. I mean, be brave. There's an evolutionary advantage to being brave. Staying and fighting rather than running away. And it's the same for most animals. If you run away from a dangerous predator or an enemy, you live your life in constant fear that you're going to have to encounter that enemy again. If you stay and bravely fight it, you run the chance of killing it, or at least scaring it away so it doesn't come back and do you again. That fight or flight response is hardwired in all of us, but we have a choice of which option to take. running away is a temporary solution. Yes, it deals with the immediate situation, but not the underlying problem. Be brave. Face your fears. Start. Take action. Let me play that note again. Woo! That was a high one. That was Pavarotti. That's the high note. It's a high note, all right. But ladies and gentlemen, it's not the high note. The role of Jesus in Jesus Christ Superstar is one of the most coveted in musical theater. It's got everything. It's got dynamicism, range, emotion, and the high note. Let me play it for you. Ooh! Up there, that's a high one. You know, let me play it again. That's very, very high. Even the girls, you would struggle with that one. This is not one, not two, not three, but four notes higher than a high C. Four notes higher than the note that made Pavarotti famous. And it's not found in the world of opera. It's found in the world of rock opera. That movie I saw when I was 7 years old changed my life. Superstar. And it's sung by Jesus, and the song is Gethsemane. Comes at a pivotal point in the show where Jesus questions the sacrifice he's about to make. And if you're thinking, well, how on earth can that be possible to sing, I've put together some recordings just to prove that it can be done. The first one is from 1969, the concept album that Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber put together. He brought some rockers of the day into the studio and he said, look, we've written the show, we've written the notes, and look, don't pay too much attention to them because we want you to kind of run with it and see what you can do by yourself. And they went, all right. And they went into the studio and they did it. And one of the guys he brought in to try the role of Jesus was a guy who they were never going to quite know was going to set the template with that note. Luckily, they brought in the lead singer of Deep Purple, Mr. Ian Gillan. Unbelievable timbre, just that pure note there. No raspy sandpaper quality. Unbelievable. And what about the movie Jesus? The guy who did it for me in the first place. My hero, Mr. Ted Neely. Lord, why should I die? Does it for me every time. Unbelievable. Hey, what about Australia's first Jesus? That would be, of course, Mr. Trevor White. Lord, unbelievable, that voice is great. Now, if you're going to have Trevor White, you're probably all thinking, well, what about John Farnham's version? Yeah, okay, we'll play John Farnham's version. Here it comes. Wait, what? Did you hear that? He didn't even go for it. It's a high note. It's so high that John Farnham didn't even go for it. It's a high note, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, so what have we had? We've had the Englishman. We've had two Aussies. What about, a bit closer to home, the Kiwi? What's the Kiwi guy? What was he like? What could he do? It's a serious, serious underpant-sized note. And I should know because, well, that was me. Yep, so anyway, look, Gethsemane. It's the perfect embodiment of what the next lesson in learning life's, how to hit life's high notes. And that's momentum. Action leads to momentum. Let me show you. I'm not going to do the whole song because it's a 5-minute volcanic epic and these days I need a cup of tea and a lie down after it. So I'm just going to do the end of what is Gethsemane.
Inspired. Now I'm sad and tired. After all I've tried for 3 years, seems like 90. Why then am I scared? scared to finish what I started. What you started, I didn't start it. God, thy will is hard, but you hold every card. I will drink your cup of poison. Nail me to your cross and break me. Bleed me, beat me, kill me. But take me now before I change my mind.
That song, extraordinary, and the way it builds. It takes you through the five steps of death described by psychologists in the 60s. First, you know, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and then finally, acceptance. And it moves you, even if you don't want to be moved. And that's what momentum is all about. Creating action that sweeps you and others up in itself, and creating action is incredibly important when it comes to hitting high notes. Success is action. Consistent, persistent action. Action is the key. We may all be the most talented people in the world and have the best ideas, but if we don't take action, we'll achieve nothing. Sports fans. Hands up, we've got a sports fans in the room. Like a bit of sports? Yeah. I'm personally a recovering cricket tragic, but I like a lot of sports, and to me, most teams have one thing in common. When you watch a game, after a while, it becomes pretty apparent of which team has momentum, or if neither of them have it. And the team that has momentum, well, they just seem to get this synergy going, don't they? They work well together. There's this beautiful kind of invisible flow. It becomes apparent that they're just at the top of their game. Likewise, there'll be times when you're more productive. When you have the best ideas, you get great results, where you're quickly able to accomplish those things that you set out when you had at the start. And it's all thanks to momentum. But here's the thing. It's very rare that momentum is built from the start. From the start? That's when footy teams are a little bit jittery, isn't it? It takes a while before they start to get that flow and get into it. It's not later that really momentum happens later in the game. And it's all thanks to action. In 1998, when we did that first show with the three waiters, we could have all given ourselves a bunch of high fives, had a few drinks, and gone home. But instead, we knew there was something about that show. We knew we had a business opportunity. We sat down, we put some plans together. We would put some promotional material out there. We started knocking on some doors, making some phone calls. We took action, and that created momentum. Taking action is so important because it gives birth to momentum. The law of inertia says a body at rest tends to stay at rest, or a body in motion tends to stay in motion. So we've got to get moving. Create the tiniest of acts can create the most enormous power, and it all creates momentum. Whew, okay, so where are we up to? Peak performance, hitting high notes, requires a purpose and a vision. Setting a goal, a clear overarching idea of what it is you want to achieve. That's lesson number one. We know that purpose alone isn't enough. We have to be brave and take action. We have to be brave and make a start. And we have to keep taking action. And we have to keep trying and improving until we can build up some momentum. Because when we have momentum, great things start to happen. But here's the other thing. Momentum comes, and damn it, it goes. There are times when you're going to feel you just don't know how you're going to get to the next step. There are times you feel you're not sure how you're ever going to hit that next high note. There are going to be times when momentum is a weird thing. This is the thing that, though, it bugs me about speakers who talk about success. I love business speakers talking about success, but the ones who talk about it as if it was easy and it was always going to happen. Oh, yes, it was easy. No, I just, you know, had this 5-point plan and then biff and then, oh, if only. It doesn't work like that, because there is no success without failure. There are no high notes without low notes. This is the thing you've got to always remember about the coming going of momentum. I went from being a chorus member in Les Mis, an understudy in Chess, and a lead role in Superstar. And somewhere in there, I won the Australian Singing Competition and did Hey Hey Saturday, midday show. And then soon after that, I'm performing with Sarah Brightman and right through Australasia doing the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber. I'm appearing with Todd McKinney on the Sydney Opera House stage doing World Goes Round. I'm producing and starring as John Lennon and Looking Through a Glass Onion, an evening with John Lennon in Words and Music, the New Zealand tour. I've been asked to join Glenn Shorrock and Doug Parkinson around Australia in the Let It Be Lennon McCartney concert, and also some ex-members of Split Enz with the New Zealand Symphony Orchestra. The first year of The Three Waiters, we had 5 performers, and we did about 50 shows. We had teams in Sydney, London, Los Angeles, and even Bogota, Colombia. Now, I'm mentioning all these because obviously these are high notes for various reasons in various ways. But when I talk about it like that, I sound like one of those guys. That it was easy. Oh, it was always going to happen. I mean, you know, I just had purpose and vision. I took action, and then we built momentum. Yes, yes, yes. But as we all know, we're skin and bone, flesh and blood, and it's how we feel that really matters in our lives. When I look back at it, with all of the ups and downs, it's the setbacks and the struggles that really is what I remember from it. And all those setbacks and troubles just reminds you of your own humanity, your own humility. Because at the end of the day, I realize I'm just an average guy from Sydney who's done okay. Not always a success, but certainly not a failure. As a showman, as a performer and producer of shows, I believe that your resilience is far more important than your talent in governing personal success and failure. And it's a mindset we've got to pay constant attention to. Because if I let success make me complacent and moving forward and staying motivated, I will fail. If I don't ensure that failure renews my humility, sharpens my objectivity, and makes me more resilient, well, I'll continue to fail. If I really want motivational goals that truly motivate me, I've got to use phrases like I will and I must, not I'll try. If I don't take action, I'm going to fail by default. So what have we got to lose? Whether we succeed or fail, there's one universal truth. We can't change what's happening to us, but we can change how we respond. Because resilience isn't about avoiding crises. It's about how we meet the challenge they represent. And as a showman, I often impress on my performers to make resilience a part of their mindset. Preparation a part of their routine. And it's the same in life. In 2000, The Three Waiters was the hottest act, corporate entertainment act in Australia. But we wanted to take it to the world. Right in the middle of the Sydney Olympic Games, we set up a team in London in the UK. The days when $1 got you 33 pence. Yes, there were a lot of pretty tough times, but to be honest, the London story is a really good story. We hit the ground running, and it actually launched pretty quickly. So quickly, and emboldened us. And within 10 months later, we were heading across the Atlantic to the big old bad US of A. Has anyone here ever been involved in a startup operation in the United States of some sort, business thing? You've probably heard rumors that it's pretty tricky, it's pretty hard. And it is. To me, it's about two or three times harder. The working visas you have to attain, the sheer size of the country, the American habitual behavior of over-promising and under-delivering, state taxes versus federal taxes versus convention center taxes. Ah, nightmare. And this is when $1 got you 50 cents. And hardly anyone had even heard of the three tenors, which were the pivotal act we used in describing the impact and imagery of the show. So it took a long time to get the train out of that station. And you have to make a lot of tremendous splashes in the big cities if you want to take advantage of a ripple effect, as was the case in Australia and the UK. But we did it, we put our head down, and just as we put together a fantastic team of about 16 people, and we were even starting to sell a few shows, Osama bin Laden entered the scene, and everything changed overnight. I was in Sydney at the time, and I remember flying into LA a month to the day on a virtually empty 747 with a wife and a little bub, and arriving at a really scary time. And when I arrived, I found that those gigs that we had been able to sell, well, most of them had just been postponed or cancelled. Understandably, people didn't want to be seen to be putting on lavish events and parties. And of course, now no one wanted to fly. That's a big problem in the United States. Oh yeah, and there was also a little thing about money, regular amounts of money being taken out from our bank account for our lovely accountant. All of a sudden we hit a brick wall, 180 degrees, we were in trouble. I remember late November, December 2001, sitting in a room just like this with the cream of Los Angeles party planners, people who did the big Hollywood parties. And there was the president of the association up here by the podium. The phones, with the tears running down his face. The phones are not ringing, people. What the hell are we going to do? And I remember thinking, what are we going to do? And I remember the Q word running around my head as we went back to the Marina Del Rey apartment most nights, wondering how on earth I could possibly turn things around. Victor Hugo said, people do not lack strength, they lack will. Some reason or another, I didn't think of it, I just couldn't quit because of everything that we'd achieved. I think you just call it good old-fashioned hardcore resilience. Resilience reminded us of our purpose. Purpose demanded that we be brave, having to once again retake that first step, spurred action. Action provided new momentum. I began what became the hardest working six-month period I can remember. There's a three-hour difference between LA and the East Coast, so I'm up every morning talking to prospective East Coast clients. I've heard of getting hold of databases and sending out hundreds of VHS cassette tapes. I'm forever going to the association networking meetings, trying to get the Americans to understand that there's this awesome product right at their fingertips if I could just get them to give a goddamn and watch the promo video. I'm going to every event I could, making sure that the boys are turning up on time, looking good, sounding good, so that the overall effect of having the three waiters at any event was a thoroughly enjoyable one. In other words, just as we'd done in Australia and the UK from the ground up, building, maintaining, nurturing the brand. Purpose, action, momentum, resilience. By the time Mark came to swap places with me, I'd been able to take the show from the immediate effects of post-9/11 despair, which is what it was, to one that looked like it had real legs again. I mean, when I started that six-month thing, we had 8 confirmed gigs for the foreseeable future. 6 months later, we'd already performed 32, and there was a whole heap coming up. Really happy to say that we stuck it out, because within a year, the three waiters started to win one of several US event Entertainer of the Year awards. Now, when you think of the idea which came out of that little townhouse in Redfern, and you think of the size and scope of the US events industry, that, ladies and gentlemen, is no mean feat. But that's what happens. You start with a purpose and vision. You be brave and make a start. You take action, and that creates momentum. And if you're able to dodge the curveballs that are going to be chucked your way, if you have the resilience to persevere and never give up, not only do you gain success, you gain self-belief. And that is the ultimate high note. When you truly believe in what you are doing, you can achieve anything. Colonel Sanders, remember those 2 years he was living out the back of his car, going to over 1,000 restaurants throughout the United States, trying to sell that damn chicken recipe? He did it because he believed it so much. He was passionate about it, and he had the courage to make it happen for himself. Babe Ruth, greatest baseball player in history, unbelievable player. Have you seen the black and white footage? Unbelievable. 714 home runs. It's been a record for decades. But he also had 1,330 strikeouts. That's a record for decades. Why is that? Self-belief. An extraordinary man when people met him. Big guy, absolute contempt for the pitcher. Even if the guy had struck him out and passed, this guy was going out of the field. Huge, massive swing. Sometimes he struck out. But sometimes he hit that thing right out of the park. Incredible example of self-belief. After 11 years of setting the three waiters up, Australia, UK, America, we now had him performing all over the world. I decided I wanted to step back and see what I could do on my own. I had helped create a show that became number one in the world. I was, always will be, extremely proud of my association with the Three Waiters. But in May 2009, because I still had not lost that rock and roll itch, I wanted to go and see what I could do by myself. In May 2009, I sold my complete shareholding in the company to Mark and the new partners, and since then, I've never been affiliated with the show. So I'm not selling you the show today. I don't care if you book it or not, because I don't make a cent. However, if you do, you will never forget it. Great as the experience had been, I wanted to go and see what I could do by myself. During the Three Waiters, I learned that creating things, dreaming things up and making them reality, damn, that was sexy. That's what drove me. I realized I wasn't just a performer or a producer. I was now a showman. And now I had a new purpose.
Lovegrove Entertainment are Australia's number one producers of first-class entertainment acts for the events industry. Shows such as Jersey to Motown, Swingin' La Vida Loca, The Leading Men, Daryl and Harmony, party band The Love Groovers, and the revolutionary new DJ experience, Time Machine Dance Party. Lovegrove Entertainment are the event planner's dream solution.
Yes, lots of bling and blang, and that's the welcome to the world of corporate entertainment. And you can see all those shows in there. They've all got their stories of once upon a time having a vision, a purpose, blah, 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 all that kind of stuff. But what's, of course, I wish there were more shows up there to join that show reel, but of course, somewhere along the line, not everything works, and a few of them have tanked. And that's all good, all part of the human condition of what happens. Just reminding me that I'm an average guy from Sydney who's done okay. Not always a success, not always a failure. But not a failure either. But of course, there's lots of high notes in there. But in between, there are lots of low notes. For every successful audition, dozens of failed ones. Every time I'm up there on stage in front of 2,000 people every night, month after month, singing the big notes, there's heaps I missed in rehearsal. Peak performance is not one act. It's not hitting one high note. It's hitting a high note again and again. It's a never-ending cycle of purpose, action, momentum, resilience, self-belief, and passion. No one notices the cycle. No one sees the effort and the hard work. No one remembers the failures along the way, because just like the X Factor and The Voice, and those singing shows, high notes are what gets you noticed. High notes are what you are remembered for. I know we're running out of time, so I just wanted to give you one example, well, probably the only example I've ever had of being a patient for the guy who saved my bacon one night. And this is my way of saying that when I heard I was going to be talking in front of you guys, I felt extremely like out of my league, because 3 years ago when I was in a Christchurch motel, next day I was going to fly down to Invercargill in New Zealand to host a big event. It's the fun. As Mick Jagger said, "Arts end of the world," but we don't have to worry about that. I had a massive burst of pain, and I had for a year, every 3 months to the dot almost, what was, I found out later, a gallstone thing. And I was in the motel one night, it started at 10 o'clock, and by the time I got to 1 o'clock, I couldn't stand it anymore. So I rang emergency services, and this fantastic paramedic came in. We had a great chat. He filled me with morphine, and he said, "Sorry, man, I'm not going to be able to let you stay here in the motel. You have to come to the hospital with me." I said, "But I've got a 7 o'clock flight." And he said, "Sorry, buddy, it's the way it goes." "That's true, is it?" He wasn't lying. "Yeah, right, okay." So I had to get to the hospital, and all the way there, we're having a good old chat while I was off my face on morphine. But anyway, I can't remember his name, but it gives me a chance to say on everybody outside of this building, thank you for your service. You know, they say for every light on Broadway, there's a broken heart, an unrealized dream. And of course, that's the same for every profession, isn't it? So you have to want it more than anybody else. You have to be your own champion, be your own superstar. Blaze your own path. Say yes to opportunity. Follow that gut instinct. Be eager and passionate. Keep learning, nurturing your real lasting relationships. Don't be a jerk. And keep freeing your imagination so that you can be all that you want to be. I know that I just want to be on stage, and I'm here. I can't really imagine being anywhere else. But life is your stage. You're on stage too. Life is your stage. And you are perfectly cast in your life to go out and sing, metaphorically, and now, literally. Remember at the beginning I said we're going to learn how to sing life's high notes, and we're going to do that by showing everybody in this room that we can sing opera. CAA 2017, are you ready? Yeah! I said, are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. Remember that note? Remember that note we started at the beginning, that high note? Which note did that make? Which opera singer became famous because of that note? Who can remember? Pavarotti, fantastic. But it wasn't the high note, wasn't it? Can anybody remember the high note? G. It was G, that's right, up there. Boy, that's a high note up there. That's even the girls would struggle with that one. That's a high note. Does anybody reckon they could get that note? Yeah, I'm not surprised. It'd be pretty brave, but there's a difference between belief and delusion. So let's not go there. We don't need to go there. Let's go back to this one for a minute. Let's go high C. Who reckons they could get that one? Who reckons they could get that one? Come on. Come on. We're talking about, you know, senior middle management, former paramedics, doing the sirens, all the living the dream and ambulances. Well, yeah, that's right. Are you soprano or can alto? But you can get it. Go on, give us a little bit. Lovely, fantastic. Now, boys, that's not hard. You just got to, you know, do the same thing. Right, well, I tell you what, though, most of us would still struggle. So let's do this one. This one's going to come. It's a high B. Here it comes. It's a high B. It's one down. It's still a high note. It's just another one, okay? This note didn't make Pavarotti famous, but he made it famous, because this is the note that finishes the very famous aria Nessun Dorma from the opera called Turandot, which of course was made famous by the three tenors when they formed about 25 years ago, and all of a sudden they had a huge resurgence, and the world's been listening to Nessun Dorma ad nauseum ever since. And that's the note. And I think this is the time we're going to seriously have a look at this high B, because this is the one we're going to do, and it's all going to be a beautiful thing. Nessun Dorma, huh? Nessun Dorma. What is it about this aria, Nessun Dorma? It's kind of like the stairway to heaven of our generation, isn't it? Every second person goes on the bloody X Factor and does their version of it, and everyone makes a record and they have their version on it. What is it about Nessun Dorma? I'll tell you. It's the closest piece of music man has ever come up with that parallels the act of lovemaking. Well, for one thing, it only takes about 2.5 minutes. That gentle promise, that whispered foreplay. And then as it builds, it develops its own rhythm and tension. And then finally it arrives, that bareback, guilt-free climax, vincerò, victory. Vincerò, vincerò. Easy melody too. La, 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 la. Let's have a go at that. Ready? Here we go. La, 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 la. Fantastic. Now, the word is vincerò, okay? It's the Italian for victory. And we just do it twice. So it's a vincerò, vincerò. Here we go. Vincerò, vincerò. CAA 2017, the time has come. It is going to be, I know you're all spread out, you're all pretty tired, I get it, I know. But look, we're going to do this. This is going to be amazing. It is now time to find that inner Kermit, Kylie Minogue, Barry Manilow, whatever it is, you've got to find it. Then in a rock or opera singer, and it's time to put your future, so you can put your future grandchild on your knee, or current one, and say, oh yes, yes, I've swum the bluest oceans and climbed the highest mountains. But back in 2017, I once sang the end of Nessun Dorma. They're going to be very impressed. I'll know exactly what you're talking about, okay? So we're going to do this thing. All right. It's going to be a beautiful thing. Now, I'm going to sing the aria, and when we get to the bit when the female chorus comes in, we know we're looking at our last 100 meters. And there's that glorious finish line. And everyone's going to respect each other in the morning, and it's going to be a beautiful thing when we all come and do it. Okay? Got it. Can't hold back. Come on. I'm looking at some of the most remarkable people in this country, in this room, and I know that you can do this. You're going to let it out, everything. I said we're going to sing opera. I didn't say that we're all going to sing opera well. All right? So it's just about having a go. And we're going to just absolutely get rid of everything we've got. Good luck when we get to that bit in the middle, when the female chorus comes in. That's the last bit which will come up on stage. If you know the words on the screen, if you know the words, please join in. But when we get to the end, we're going to stand up together, take that deep breath, and absolutely let everybody in Adelaide know who is in the house. All right. Good luck. Don't let me down. If you don't join in, it's terribly un-Australian. And I think names will be taken, and you have to pay a higher fee for next year's conference. All right, good luck. We'll see you then. Vincerò, victory. Thank you.
Nessun dorma, oppure o principessa, nella tua fredda stanza, guardi le stelle che tremano d'amore e di speranza. Mia.
The doors are locked, you can't run or hide. It's going to be a beautiful thing.
Bobby.
Stand up, let's do it, CA. Come on, here we go. Thank you so much.
Come on up. I just want to say, I don't know, a lot of speakers, they have books to sell. I don't have anything to sell. But if you would like some free tracks I've put together, please go and check out darylovetogrove.com, and there's just grab some tracks. There's some really great tracks you'll enjoy. Put in your car stereo and listen to. I think you'll enjoy them a lot. Thank you so much, everybody. Take care.